So discussing properties of tensors in 3+1 dimensional Minkowski space, okay, and we in last class we discussed how the components, given the contravariant components of a vector or a tensor, how to obtain the covariant components of respective vectors and tensors, okay, and how they transform, why we call certain combination of vectors like this one, vectors and tensors, certain combination of them are scalar, combination is not scale. Why it comes? Because of, it comes because of their transformation properties. Okay, fine. So now, so I think we are discussing, I have specified the metric already. Yeah, the tensors in special relativity. Okay, so now the next thing which I would like to do is, so there are other properties of tensors also that we would like to discuss now. Okay, so consider a tensor of rank mn that rank m0. Okay, so it will be, so this is a tensor of rank m0, okay, or you consider a tensor of rank mn, tensor of rank mn, okay, in 3+1 dimensions. Okay, so how many components does this tensor have? Okay, so how many independent components does this tensor have? So for the five tensor of rank mn, then you will have, you will be having m upper indices and n lower indices. Okay, so how many components does this tensor have? So we are in 3+1 dimension, so each index can take 4 values. Okay, so how many entries, if I write this as a multi-dimensional matrix, then how many entries will be there, independent entries?
4⋅mn.
4⋅m. Mn or what?
Sir, m plus n.
M plus n.
M
plus n.
Okay. So this will have m plus n independent components. Okay. So any tensor of rank mn will have, in general, 4⋅m+n independent components. Okay. So to be specific, let us consider tensor of rank 2⋅. So it will have t mu nu. So it will be having, this is your 2⋅. So it will be 4⋅2. Okay. So it will have 16 independent components. Similarly for covariant tensor, similarly for mixed tensor. Okay, number of independent component, okay, does not change if they are not going to change. Okay, the sum is, sum matters, this m plus n. Okay. Now, this number of independent components will get reduced if you have certain symmetries. Okay, this number of independent components for this given tensor will be reduced if we have certain symmetries. Okay, so suppose if I have a tensor, suppose if I have a tensor symmetric tensor, okay, so I will first discuss symmetric tensor. So consider, for example, a tensor of rank 2⋅. So T min. Okay. It's called symmetric if this is equal to T nu min. So I'm discussing in the component wise. Okay. What would have happened if I want to discuss this in abstract way? So this is 2-0 tensor. So T will be given by T mu nu E mu direct product with E nu. Okay. This produce, if you consider tensor as a linear map, then it will act on two dual vectors, say E rho, E sigma, because it is a tensor of rank 2-0. So it will act on two dual vectors and I will get a number, say some number, say A. Okay. It does, if this tensor is symmetric, then it does not matter whether I do this or whether I do this. Okay, I will still get A. Okay, this is actually the definition of symmetric tensor, but it boils down to this. Okay, so a tensor is symmetric if it does not change under the alteration of indices. Okay. So this is a tensor, so this is a symmetric tensor of rank 2. I can also consider symmetric tensor of rank 3, mu nu rho. So suppose this is totally symmetric tensor. Okay, what does it mean? It means that T, if you interchange any of these two indices, okay, it won't change. This tensor will not change. So T mu nu rho is same as T nu mu rho is same as T nu, etc. Under the interchanges of any two indices. So it is called totally symmetric tensor. Okay. It is symmetric in all indices. It might happen that we have a tensor, say rank 3-0, which is symmetric in first two. Okay. Is it clear? Then if I interchange first two indices, it will not change. If I interchange first two indices, I will get the same tensor. But it is not guaranteed that if I interchange, say, second and third or first and third, I will get the same tensor. That is not guaranteed. So this is the tensor which is symmetric in first two indices. Similarly, we can have tensor of rank M0, which is symmetric in any of its indices, any number of indices. If it's symmetric in all indices, then we say that the tensor is totally symmetric tensor. Okay. So now the question is, in general, we have 4 to the power m+1 independent components. Okay. So suppose if I have tensor of rank m0, okay, then how many components, suppose this is not symmetric, there is no symmetry mentioned. So how many components are there? 4 to the power 2, that is 16 components. Okay, or 4 to the power m components. Right? Okay? Clear? Or let me be specific. Suppose you consider 2-0. Okay, then it is good to have one number. So then I will put m, then I have 16 components. Okay, now suppose this tensor T menu is symmetric. Then this, obviously the number of independent components are going to be reduced. Okay. So what will be that number? The number of independent components of 2 0 tensor. What will be that number in 3 plus 1 dimension? What will be that number? Any answer?
No, sir, 10.
How?
10, sir. 10.
Sir, we will subtract the diagonal elements first from 16. So that will be 4 diagonal elements, so 12. And half of that because they are symmetric. And then add the diagonal elements again to get the total independent.
Okay. So in general, if I have n dimension, then this is 4 dimension. In 4 dimension, you have 10. So if I have n dimensions, then if I have n dimensions, then what should I do? So you're correct. So in 4 dimension, I have 10 independent components. Okay. So in general, if I have n dimension, that means n minus 1 plus 1 dimension space time. So there are n minus 1 spatial dimension and 1 time dimension.
So you mean the Minkowski space?
Yeah, Minkowski, it does not matter, right? So it only the total dimension of space matters as far as the symmetry property of tensor is concerned, right? So what should I write here for n dimension?
N square minus
So I will tell you the result and then you can
N square it. Minus n by 2 plus n.
N into n plus 1 by 2. Okay. So this will be the number of independent components. You can convince yourself. You go and check. Okay. So the number of independent components will be reduced from 16 to 10 if I have symmetric tensor. Okay. Yeah. So this is tensor of rank 20. You can do the same thing if I give you tensor of rank 30 and if I say that it is totally symmetric tensor. Okay, then it will be then the number of independent components before imposing the symmetry will be 4 to the power 3. Okay. There. Now after imposing the symmetry, if I say now that it is symmetric, then any symmetry, whether it is symmetric tensor or the anti-symmetric tensor, which I'm going to introduce in a moment, it will reduce the number of independent components of tensor. Okay. So next, suppose if someone gives you a tensor, okay. Menu, okay, then what will be the symmetric part of this? What will be the symmetric part? I am not saying the T menu is symmetric, but I should be able to extract out symmetric part of this tensor. That means I should be able to construct a symmetric tensor from this, only from this, because this is given to you. Okay. So what will be the symmetric part of T menu? It's very easy to construct. So symmetric part of T menu is denoted by round brackets T menu. Okay. So this represents the symmetric part of this tensor. It will be what? It will be T mu nu. I want to consider the symmetric combination using this tensor. So it will be T mu nu plus T nu mu divide by 2. If I do this, you can see that this is resulting tensor, which is this, is symmetric. Is it clear? Yeah, because this, if I interchange mu nu, then I have to interchange mu nu, then this will go here and this will go here, right? So it is again T, same tensor. This tensor is denoted by this symbol, symmetric part of this tensor. Is it clear? Okay. Suppose if I give you tensor of rank 3, 0, and if I ask you to symmetrize it, symmetrize P mu nu rho. Okay. That means you have to write the symmetric part of this. Now, how to write symmetric part of this? What should I do? This tensor of rank 3, 0. You have to consider all the permutations of mu nu rho. Right? You consider all the permutations. So it is denoted by round mu nu rho. Okay. You have to consider all the permutations. So how many permutations will be there?
Of three indices.
Three factorial. So that factor will come here. Okay. And then you consider all the permutations. So T nu nu rho plus T nu mu rho plus I interchange first two. Okay, then I will interchange T rho nu plus T rho mu nu, etc. So there will be these many terms. Okay. Is it clear? So if I want to write strategically, you first consider cyclic permutations. Okay. Mu nu. So okay, so let me complete this. 1/3 factorial. Okay. T mu nu rho plus, you consider the cyclic permutation of this. So it will be T nu rho mu plus T rho mu nu. So I'm moving one indices to the left, each indices to the left, and mu will go here. So in this, mu has gone to the last, nu has come to first, and rho is second. Then I will move rho here. Then, so these are the three terms. Then you interchange mu nu. Okay, and again consider its cyclic permutation. So it will be T mu rho nu plus T rho nu mu. Right? Okay. And that's it. So it will exhaust all the possibilities. Okay. So maybe you can consider T. Yeah, that's it. This exhausts all the possibilities. Okay, so this is the symmetric part of this tensor. Okay. Is it clear? Good. Now, you consider, so this is symmetric. So now you consider anti-symmetric tensor. Okay, so tensor is anti-symmetric if it changes its sign after the interchanging the indices. So if I consider tensor of rank 2, 0 in Minkowski's 3+1 dimensional Minkowski space, then T mu nu, if I interchange mu nu, then it will change sign. T mu nu equal to minus of T nu. So As a result, you can easily see that T00, T11, T22, T33, they are all zeros, right? Because T00 is equal to minus of T00. Therefore, T00 is 0. Similar will hold for T11, T22, T33, and so on. Okay? Now, how many independent components does this tensor have? Okay, this is always be 0. Okay, so you have to subtract from our previous number for symmetric tensor, you have to subtract the diagonal number. Okay, so number of independent in four dimension, if I have a tensor of rank 2 0, or in general tensor of rank 2, okay, it may be lower, it may be upper, it may be, yeah, it should not be mixed. I will tell you why, but either it will be upper or lower, it doesn't matter. Okay, so if I have tensor of rank 2 in 3+1 dimension, okay, then the number of independent components will be equal to 4 into 4 minus 1 by 2. Okay, it will be 6. Okay, in general, you will have it will be n, you can check this, n into n minus 1 by 2. Okay, just anti-symmetric, you consider just anti-symmetric, forget about tensor, just deal with the anti-symmetric matrix. Any n cross n anti-symmetric matrix, how many independent entries are there? So this is n into n minus 1 by 2. Okay. Yeah. For simplicity, I'm taking example of tensor of rank 2. You can do this for tensor of rank 3, 4, etc. Okay. Now, so this is first part. Second part is, what is the anti-symmetric part of say T mini? Now you have to consider the anti-symmetric combination. You have to consider construct anti-symmetric tensor using this given tensor. This tensor may or may not be anti-symmetric. So anti-symmetric part of T mu nu is denoted by square bracket mu nu. Okay, this is equal to 1 by 2 P mu nu minus T nu. Tensor T mu. Okay. If I have tensor of rank 3 0, and I say that it is totally anti-symmetric. Okay, so I have tensor of rank 3 0 T mu nu rho. Okay, and sorry, you consider tensor of rank 3 0, and I want to anti-symmetrize it, or I want to extract anti-symmetric part of this tensor. What should I do? I want to extract anti-symmetric part of this tensor. What should I do? Or instead of saying we want to extract anti-symmetric part of this tensor, I will say that anti-symmetrize this tensor. Okay. That means you have to construct anti-symmetric tensor from the given tensor. Okay. Okay. So what should I do now? What I need to do? We'll fix the factor afterwards, but what will be the terms? What will be the terms? First, you write T mu nu rho. Okay. If you interchange, then you consider as before. You consider the cyclic curve, cyclic permutations. What is going to happen? If I do cyclic permutation, if I interchange two indices, then the sign is not going to change. If I interchange once, then sign is going to change. If I interchange another interchange of indices, that sign will nullify the first change. So interchanging the indices twice will not produce any sign difference. Okay, so suppose if I write this term as t nu rho mu, is this will come with the plus or minus? I want to fix this sign. Is this correct or wrong?
Yes, sir. Two indices have this
so
switch.
So to obtain this one, you consider mu nu rho. Okay. Now you fix the order in your mind. Fix the order of mu nu rho. Okay. Then you interchange mu and nu. And then you interchange mu and rho, nu, rho, mu. So there are, from here to here, there are two changes, right? So there will be plus sign. Okay. Then I will consider t, rho, mu, nu. Okay. So from this, if I obtain rho, mu, nu, okay, what will be the first change? Okay. You interchange rho and nu first, so it will be mu rho nu. Okay, and you interchange rho and nu, so it will be again another two changes, so it will be plus sign. Now you consider, you flip first two indices, it will be nu mu rho. Okay, and then you consider is it clear? Okay. What will be the cyclic permutation of mu? But that all those cyclic permutations will be odd permutations of mu nu rho. Okay. So it will come with the minus sign. Minus t mu rho nu minus t rho nu mu. Okay. Is it clear? Clear. Okay. Now you consider. Now I think we have exhausted all the possibilities. Okay. Because if I write mu nu. Yeah. Suppose if I write t rho. If I interchange first and third rho nu mu. Rho nu mu is already there. Okay, so we don't require, we have exhausted all the possibilities. Okay, so this is the anti-symmetrization of third rank tensor, and the factor will be, what factor will come? It will be three factor. Okay, is this process clear? Anti-symmetrization of any tensor. Same will hold for t mu nu and t mu nu rho. Okay. Is this clear? Anti-symmetrization and anti-symmetrization? Any doubt? We will use this frequently.
Yeah, so sir, once the order is fixed, I mean, the index in Levi-Civita are determined, then...
Levi-Civita, where is the Levi-Civita here? I have not yet introduced Levi-Civita. Levi-Civita is a very particular tensor. I'm saying that you consider that any anti-symmetric, we are discussing the anti-symmetric tensor. Levi-Civita is one of the anti-symmetric tensors. We'll see what extra properties that Levi-Civita tensor has. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Fine. So now, suppose if I give you a tensor, suppose if I give you two tensors, A mu nu and B mu nu. And if I say that B mu nu is symmetric. If I say that the B mu nu is symmetric, okay, then what is this combination? A mu nu, B quantity is this.
What? Tensor of rank 2.
Huh?
Tensor of rank 2.
Tensor of rank 2. No. You see the placement of indices. What type of quantity is this?
Scalar.
So, but tensor of rank 2 is not a scalar. Okay. Tensor of rank 2.
Repeated index.
So this is the tensor of rank 2. It's not a scalar. These indices are summed over. Okay. So this is scalar quantity. Fine. Now I'm saying that this B mu nu is symmetric. Okay. This B mu nu is symmetric. Then can you say something about this combination? You show if A mu nu and B mu nu are two tensors of rank 2, 0 and 0, 2, and B mu nu is symmetric, then show that only symmetric part of A mu nu would contribute to the scalar A mu nu B mu nu. Okay, you understand this? You have to show this. Show that only symmetric part of A mu nu would contribute to the scalar A mu nu B mu nu. See, if B mu nu is not symmetric, or if there is no symmetry for B mu nu, then the number which you get for this, okay, is different than if I impose extra property. Is it clear? In this case, only symmetric part of A mu nu will contribute. Why I'm discussing this example? The reason is following. Any tensor, say A mu nu, we know how to symmetrize it, we know how to anti-symmetrize it. Hence, any tensor I can write as symmetric part plus anti-symmetric part, right? This I can always do. You can check what is the symmetric part of this A mu nu, half A mu nu plus A nu nu. Okay, what is the anti-symmetric part of this tensor? Half A mu nu minus A nu nu. Okay, so this cancels with this, and this will add factor 2 will give me 1. So A mini equal to A mini, right? So I can always write any tensor as a sum of symmetric tensor and anti-symmetric tensor. Okay, this you can always do. Now what this exercise is telling you is that if you consider this combination and if one of the tensor is symmetric, then only symmetric part of other tensor will contribute to this number. This is what it tells. You have to show this. Similarly, consider two tensors A, mu, and nu, and symmetric. If B, mu, is anti-symmetric, then show that only anti-symmetric part of A mu nu would contribute to a scalar A mu nu B mu nu. Okay, please do this exercise. If you don't do this, you will not understand the action formulation of electromagnetism. Okay, it's as simple as that. Fine. So as a byproduct of these two, suppose if I consider a symmetric tensor, suppose this is symmetric and this is anti-symmetric. Suppose A mu is symmetric and B mu is anti-symmetric. Okay, then now tell me quickly what will be this. What will be this result? Just use this.
Zero.
Correct. So this will be zero. Okay. I will just mention you how this comes. Okay. That technique you can use to show this too. Okay. So you have A mu nu, B mu nu. Okay. So this you can write as half of A mu nu, B mu nu, plus half of, see, these are dummy indices, right? These are repeated indices. I can always write like this, A nu mu, B nu mu, right? Is it clear? Okay. I am not in second term. Second term is same as first one. I just change the indices everywhere. I have not used symmetry or anti-symmetry. I change the indices, dummy indices. Okay. Now you use the fact that B mu is anti-symmetric, or you use the fact that A mu is symmetric, any. Okay, suppose if okay, and the second in second term I will use the fact that B mu is anti-symmetric, so I can write the second term as minus of half A nu mu. Okay, and B mu nu. Now you see, now I interchange the indices, so I will take now B mu nu common, so half B mu nu A mu nu minus A nu nu, which is given to you that A mu nu is symmetric, right? So this is equal to half B mu nu A mu nu minus A mu nu. It is. Okay, clear? So if you contract if you take product, if you contract symmetric tensor with anti-symmetric tensor, that contraction will fully full contraction. Okay, that result of full contraction will be zero. Is it clear? Okay, so this is one part. Okay, now next, okay, right, so now what I will do, okay, so what I wanted to discuss, okay, I forgot what I wanted to discuss. There's something regarding this symmetry or anti-symmetry I wanted to discuss. Just give me a second. I'm forgetting something. What happened? To discuss some important point regarding this. Yeah, so you can have symmetric tensor or anti-symmetric tensor when you have either totally contravariant or covariant tensors. Okay, it makes no sense to talk about the symmetry for this type of tensor, because see, one index is contravariant, another index is covariant, so the nature of these two indices are different. So it makes no sense to talk about the interchanging of indices. It makes no use. What I mean is the following. Suppose if I say by hand that T mean is symmetric, okay, what do I mean by that? It means this, but it has no meaning, because now, see, now this indices has changed its character. It should not happen, right? If I say that this is symmetric, that means I have to interchange some indices. If I interchange these indices, okay, that means I am changing this. For mixed tensors, but given the mixed tensor, you can always write this mixed tensor as T mu. You can always write as eta nu rho T mu rho, right? Okay, and if this, you can talk now about the symmetry property of this. You can convert a given mixed tensor to either contravariant or covariant, and then you talk about the symmetry or anti-symmetry property of that tensor. Okay, as it stands, this mixed tensor, it makes no sense to talk about the symmetry or anti-symmetric property, because one index is contravariant, while another index is covariant. It makes no sense to interchange them. Is this clear? Is this fact clear? Okay, good. Occasionally, we may come across a tensor which is, suppose I have a tensor which is symmetric in first two, okay, and anti-symmetric in last two. So it is symmetric in first two and anti-symmetric in last two. Okay, fine. So occasionally we may find this kind of tensors, or given a tensor T mu nu rho sigma, we may have to do anti-symmetrization over last two indices and symmetrization over first two indices. So the problem will be the following. Anti-symmetrize T mu nu rho sigma in last two indices. Okay, so what you will do? T mu nu rho sigma will be what? Tell me, what will be the anti-symmetrization of this? How many indices I am anti-symmetrizing? 2. So there will be factor of 2 factorial. Okay. Then T mu nu rho sigma minus T mu nu sigma rho. That's it. So it is anti-symmetric in last two indices. Similarly, now I want symmetrization in first two indices. Okay. So consider this individually and symmetrize it further in last two indices, in first two indices. Okay. What I will do, I will keep this as it is. I will attach 2 factorial extra, and then T mu nu rho sigma plus T nu mu rho sigma minus, you do anti-symmetrization of this T mu nu rho sigma minus T nu mu rho sigma. Sigma, sorry, this is mu mu sigma rho and mu sigma rho and mu sigma rho. The okay, you will find that if I interchange mu nu, it is symmetric, and if I interchange rho sigma, it is anti-symmetric. Okay, is it clear? You may have this kind of combination also. It makes sense. Okay, you have fourth rank tensor, you have tensor of rank 2, 2. It makes sense to symmetrize it in first two indices, in first two contravariant indices, and it makes sense to anti-symmetrize it in last two covariant indices. Okay, good. Now, so there is a special tensor in Minkowski space. It's called Kronecker delta tensor. Kronecker delta tensor. It is given by, it is a tensor of rank 1, 1. Okay, it is given by delta mu nu. Okay, why it is special? So it is defined as, this is equal to 1 when mu equal to nu and equal to 0 when mu not equal to nu. Why it is special? Let us see. If I see the transformation property of delta mu nu under general coordinate transformation, how this will transform? Tell me delta prime mu nu, how it will transform? Tell me the answer. Suppose under x goes to x prime, how this is going to transform? Hmm? del x prime mu del x alpha del x nu, sorry, del x beta and del x prime nu, correct? It will transform in a contravariant, like a contravariant vector as far as this upper index is concerned, and it will transform like a covariant vector as far as this lower index is concerned. Okay, so this is what I have written, and then delta alpha beta. Now you see indices are properly placed. Is it clear? So in our shorthand notation, which I defined yesterday, it will be del alpha x prime mu del prime nu x beta. Okay, delta alpha beta. But normally when we are writing transformation, it usual practice to write like this. In calculation, we use this shorthand, but while doing this transformation, it is always better to write like this. It makes no harm even if you write like this, but you have to be careful. There is a prime here. Prime means derivative with respect to nth component in primed frame. Okay. Now tell me, what will be this result? Remember this thing. Now on the right hand side, you can apply this. Okay. So it will be del x prime mu. We know only about unprimed Kronecker delta, and from that we are deducing the property of primed Kronecker delta. Okay, correct. So this term will survive when alpha equal to beta. Okay, so I have to put alpha equal to beta and sum over. There is a sum over alpha, sum over beta already there. Okay, now I have to put alpha equal to beta. So it will be either you replace alpha by beta or beta by alpha. So I will replace by alpha. Okay. So I will replace beta by alpha. Okay, what will be this result? Zero if mu is not equal to nu, correct? Right. This means that delta prime mu nu is again equal to delta mu nu. So this Kronecker delta tensor has a special property that its components are all same in any coordinate system. That is the speciality. Normally, when you have a tensor, its components get changed when you do coordinate transformation. Okay, but this is the tensor whose components of delta mu nu are same in all the coordinate system. So it doesn't matter which coordinate system you are taking. Okay, the components of delta mu will be always like this. So under the change of coordinate, this nature will not go. That's why it is special. It is not true for this. This thing is not true for the following. Suppose if I construct this tensor, okay, which is say equal to 1 if mu equal to nu and equal to 0 if mu is not equal to nu. Okay. Suppose if I just by hand if I construct this tensor. So it is a tensor of rank 2, 0. How it will transform? It will transform delta prime mu nu will be del x prime mu del x alpha del x prime nu del x beta and delta alpha beta. Correct? But delta alpha beta, it will survive when alpha equal to beta. Okay, now you see the problem. Okay, so x prime mu del alpha x prime nu del alpha dx alpha. Okay, it does not guarantee us that this is equal to delta mu nu. Right? Is it clear? First of all, it you see, there is a problem with summation. One, it is a summation over all two lower indices. If you write it in shorthand, it will be clear. Del del x alpha is del alpha x prime mu. And you see now next term, what will be the next term? Del alpha x prime mu. You see there is a problem. It makes no sense to do this transformation. So it's not a tensor transformation. You see the problem here. And secondly, even if it does transform, even if we say that it transforms like a tensor, it is not, it does not preserve this kind of structure in another coordinate system. Okay, for example, if I fix, say, there is a sum over alpha and beta, so you can do, suppose if I let me do it explicitly. Del x 0, del x 0 plus this del x prime mu del x 1 del x prime nu del x 1 and so on. Okay. If I put the indices. Okay. It is not guaranteed that this equal to 1 when mu equal to nu. Right? Because x prime coordinates are, in general, they are arbitrary functions of x0, x1, x2, x3. Is it clear? Fine. So what is the time? When is your class? At 12:30, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good. Okay. So we have now Kronecker delta tensor, which is tensor of rank 1, 1. Okay. Tell me what happens if I, now we have the metric tensor. Okay. So what will be the result of this? If I do the following, we do so first tell me what will be the result of this delta mu mu. If I contract mu and nu, what will be the result? This will be what kind of quantity is this?
Scalar.
Scalar. And now tell me what number it produces.
4.
4. So it will be delta 1, 1 plus delta 2, 2 plus delta 3, 3 plus delta 4. Or delta 0 plus. Mu nu delta nu lambda. What will be this?
Tensor of rank 1.
Tensor of rank 1 or 2 0?
Sorry, 2 0.
Sorry, 0 2. It will be tensor of rank 0 2. Okay, because mu is summed over. Okay, and mu and lambda. So this is equal to eta mu lambda. What it tells is that you replace wherever there is a mu, you replace by lambda. So that is what I have done. Okay. Is it clear? Okay. This is numerically equal to delta, but now you can see that I can use metric, okay, to lower these indices, right? Suppose instead of delta nu lambda, if I write a nu lambda, and if I consider this, what you would have written? You would have written a mu lambda, right? Okay, because I have lowered this by using this metric. Similarly, I could have lowered this mu lambda. Okay, they are numerically equal, not as a tensor, they are numerically equal. Okay, is it clear? Given this tensor, firstly, if I contract upper and lower, I will get the dimensionality of the space-time. Then, if I lower these indices by using eta, I will get some symbolic tensor. This is numerically equal to this. Okay? So, that's why it is very special tensor. Is it clear? Okay. So that's why we get delta ij or eta ij equal to, when you, that's why you write eta is equal to minus of delta ij. Okay. Clear? Now you have you know symmetric tensor, anti-symmetric tensor, you know Kronecker delta. Okay, now consider, a tensor, okay, called Levi-Civita tensor. Okay, so maybe I should introduce it afterwards. Maybe I will introduce it afterwards. Okay, I will discuss, just remind me to discuss Levi-Civita tensor. Okay, because I wanted to discuss something before it, because then we can discuss some nice properties about Levi-Civita tensor. Okay, now differentiation of tensor. Okay, so given a tensor of rank 2 0, okay, there is the argument here. this tensor, partial, you can consider the partial derivative of this with respect to rho coordinate. By this time, you must have realized that I am always writing upper indexes on coordinates. So the coordinates are always written by, are always given by upper indexes, coordinates. Okay, its partial derivatives form coordinate basis. Okay, in shorthand notation, it is written like this. And it's not surprise that this rho is coming down. Okay, we have checked that this del del rho, del del x rho, indeed transform as a covariant vector that we have seen yesterday. Okay? That's why there is a reason for writing this shorthand. Then, so when you think this as a vectorial quantity, it is you can think this as a covariant vector. Okay, so now I'm differentiating this t mu with respect to del del with respect to rho coordinate. So this is in a shorthand rotation, it will be written like this. So what kind of quantity will be this? And the differentiation is defined in a usual way, like your Leibniz rule. Okay, Leibniz, your derivative by first principle and then Leibniz rule. This is your usual partial derivative on some function. You, as far as the derivative is concerned, you treat this as a function of x. Okay. So what will be this quantity? How this transform? Just think about t mu. How t mu transform? It transform like a tensor of rank 2,0. And how this quantity transform? T mu transform like a tensor of rank 2,0. And how this transform? This transform like a tensor of rank 0,1. So as a result, how this quantity will transform? How this quantity will
like
transform?
A tensor of rank 2,1.
So it will transform like a tensor of rank 40 of this, and then apply the transformation property of this and simplify. You will get the correct transformation. What I mean is, you consider this, okay, and write it, try to write it in unprimed system. Okay, so in unprimed system, this will be del x alpha by del x prime rho del del x alpha acting on d. So it's not that easy. So that's what I wanted to discuss it. Okay, so it is del x prime mu divided by del x rho I used, alpha I used, say mu is already there, so it is say beta del x prime nu by del x say gamma and then t beta gamma. Okay, now you see I have to differentiate this. Okay, so tell me, under what circumstances this will be a tensor of rank 2,1? Under what circumstances this will be a tensor of rank 2? You differentiate this, okay? What will be the first term? Del x alpha, del x prime rho, okay? First, I will differentiate this, okay? So this will remain as it is. And then differentiation of this. Okay. Plus, there will be differentiation over this. It will be some some term. Plus, there will be differentiation of this term. So it will produce something like this. Okay. Now tell me, if I say that this should be tensor of rank 2-1. Okay. That means that only this term should have survived and these other terms should have been 0. Okay. Clear? Is it clear to all? Okay, because this I can write as, you see, this entire thing, okay, is del x alpha, del x prime rho, del x prime mu by del x beta, and del x prime nu by del x. There is some mistake here I have done. Okay, nu, it should be gamma here. Okay, gamma. And del alpha t beta gamma, okay, plus some terms. Okay, if it is a tensor of rank 2-1, then only we should have got only this result up to this. Okay, this is extra part. Okay, clear? What is the conclusion from this? Okay, so let me do simple exercise just to convince you. Let me do simple exercise. Let us consider a 4-vector Vx and let us construct this quantity. What do you expect naively by seeing at the index structure? What kind of quantity would be this?
A scalar.
Scalar, okay. Now, but this is just your expectation that since the mu mu are contracted, okay, there is no free indices and hence it should be scalar. But now you see, under the coordinate transformation, what is going to happen? Del prime mu v prime mu. How it will transform? Okay, it will transform like you substitute del prime mu is del x prime mu. Okay, this will be equal to del x alpha by del x prime mu, chain rule, del x alpha. Okay, so this I will substitute here, so it will be, and I will write directly. Okay, so it will be del prime mu x alpha. Okay, are you comfortable with this notation now? Can I use this directly?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and then this del alpha. Okay, and then transformation of v prime. V prime will be, it is a contravariant vector, so it will be del x prime mu, okay, and then beta, and then v beta. Okay, this will be equal to del prime mu x alpha. Okay, then differentiation, it will be del alpha del beta x prime mu v beta plus del prime mu x alpha. Okay, and then I will differentiate this, it will be del beta x prime mu. Okay, and then del alpha v beta. Okay, fine. Now you see, it is not transforming as a scalar. I should have expect that this will give me some number. Is it as far as index is concerned? You see, alpha alpha is summed over, mu mu is summed over, beta beta is summed over. Here also alpha is getting summed over this alpha, mu is summed over, beta is summed over. But it is not a scalar. What is happening? See, I should have expect this result, right? I should have expected this result. Right? Scalar means this quantity should not change. This quantity should not change under coordinate transformation. So I should have got the same quantity. Am I getting same quantity? No. See, although the index structure is suggesting us that it is a scalar, it's not. Right? So in general, this, what is happening in for a general coordinate transformation, okay, what is happening is that this does not transform like a vector for a general coordinate transformation. Okay, for a most general coordinate transformation, this does not transform like a vector. Although the way we define it is a tangent vector, okay, and we are paying the price of that cheating. Okay, there are some transformations under which this is not transforming as a vector, but this cheating is allowed in special relativity. Why? That will be our next point. See, in special relativity, what happens? Your transformations are such that your these terms are getting cancelled. This term, or say for example, these terms, term like this, this, they will be zero. Why? Because you see, in the special relativity, what type of transformation we talk about usually? What kind of transformations are we demand? What kind of transformation? Okay, so let me ask you this question. Under what kind of transformation we demand that rule should not change, or physical property or rule or law should not change? In special relativity, what are the transformation under which a physical law is not going to change?
Lorentz transformation.
Lorentz transformation. So what kind of transformations are these Lorentz transformations? How, suppose if I have, I will discuss this, but I'm just giving you the glimpse of it. X prime and X. What kind of transformation relates this? I don't want any specific form, but you have to use some proper word, which will tell us that these terms are zero.
Linear.
Yeah. So these are a certain linear transformation. You can allow some constant. Okay. So you see that for Lorentz transformation, these kind of terms does not bother us, and this will, if you substitute this kind of transformation here, it will be, eventually it will become del alpha. You will see that it will become del alpha p alpha. Okay, in general, this does not transform as a vector for a general coordinate transformation. But in our study, where our vector space is Minkowski space, in that space, the allowed coordinate transformation under which the physical law remains unchanged are linear transformations. Okay? Clear? As far as that is concerned, this transform as a vector. That's why this cheating is allowed. Okay. In if you go ahead in your studies, and if you are taking general relativity as your course, okay, then you'll see that this cheating is not allowed. It will create problem. There you have to change the definition of this derivative. Okay. Fine. But we are not discussing that. We are on in flat space, and we are dealing with the linear transformations. Okay. So that's why this we take the this transform as a vector. And I will emphasize now that why we require this, why this is the most general Lorentz transformation. Okay. I think I should stop here. It's 12 o'clock. We have class. Okay. So I think I should stop here. And from next class, we'll discuss the more about tensors in special relativity. Okay. And we'll see the properties of Lorentz transformations. Okay. And then soon I will jump into the electrodynamics in tensor notation. Okay. That is what we require. Electrodynamics is what we require if we want to study the motion of electron. Okay. That is the ultimate aim in this course. So you have to study the quantum motion of electron. Yeah, so I will stop, and if you have any question, you can ask. Any question? Okay, I think I will end the meeting. By the way, do you have the recordings of the classes, of my first classes, for means before the break? I did some classes, right? So do you have the recordings of that? By chance, did you record it that?
Yes, sir.
Some of you?
Yes, sir, it is saved.
It is no, it's not there in my in Teams because it is expired.
It's not.
You have downloaded it.
You have downloaded it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So maybe, but is there any way to transfer? Yes. Yes. Somebody is asking some question, something. Hello.
Hello.
So what I'm saying is that go on.
Yeah. Agni saved all those lectures on, so maybe he can share you the link.
So maybe that is good. So OneDrive means where I have to go from Teams.
Yes, sir. Microsoft account has a common, the Microsoft account is common to all. For Teams and OneDrive.
So OneDrive, where I can find that OneDrive?
Sir, I will add you in my shared list with your email ID. You will get a link. You click on that link and you will directly go to that folder.
Okay, so there, but you name those folders. Name those lectures.
Yes, sir.
One first lecture, second lecture, and so
on. Yes, sir. It is named as dates.
Okay, so it will be done automatically or not?
Yes, sir, it will go automatically. If you click on that file name, the file name is denoted by the date.
Can you tell me just how to do that?
Can I share my screen?
You can share. Maybe that we can discuss in next lecture. So maybe, okay, next time you just tell me before the lecture, you come before the lecture, maybe 5 to 10 minutes before, and then you can tell me. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So by the time you just share that link, or maybe at that time you just share that link of other lectures. Okay. Don't send it me now. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So in at the time of next lecture, you come. Any one of you, those who know, you come 10 minutes before and just tell me, let me know how to do that.
Okay, sir.
Yes. Okay. Fine. So I will end the recording. And the next class will.